Here we are, back in Minety Festival fields. But what is that? Oh my God. Witch, is that you, man? It's been a year. What are you doing? You've got to let it go. You've got to let it go, brother.
Did I miss much? Did I miss much?
Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing.
This is Minety Music Festival 2020 virtual.
And this is 10th Electric.
Thank you for joining us for our festival online. So, listen, there's a couple of pieces to the format of the podcast that we're doing. Rich, why don't you talk to the audience a little bit about that?
So we wanted to do something to kind of fill the void of festivals, because I know everyone's missing them. And we figured a good idea would be to do a kind of a radio video podcast show format. We've got bands that are going to come and do live sessions for us. There's going to be live streaming on Friday night and Saturday night. There's loads of bands that would have been playing at this year's festival have sent in tracks, and we've got a series of interviews with bands so that you can get to know them a little bit hear a bit of their music and hopefully whet your appetite for next year.
So everyone's getting to grips with Zoom. You've taken it one step further and gone Zoom plus editing, and there are countless hours. And we've been able to put together a sample of some of the bands that we're going to perform this year, and some surprises coming in for next year on some epic interviews, some real insights and everything. And we've been able to eke that out through some extremely smart and intellectual questioning through our interview techniques that are done by both Rich and myself. So I really hope you sit back, put your feet up, and really enjoy what is a fantastic and epic series of interviews for your delight. Sorry we couldn't have the festival in person, but hey, we're going to bring it all back for you next year. So we're going to kick off with a whole stream of interviews that are coming your way. But before we do, I'm going to introduce the one, the only, Doctor and the Medics, to Clive. Thank you, sir, for supporting us from day one.
So, Minety Music Festival meets Doctor and the Medics. So we're joined now by the Reverend Dr. Clive Jackson of Doctor and the Medics, the man that puts the doctor into the Doctor and the Medics. Welcome to the show.
The man,
the legend.
It's the Doctor and the Medics. Yeah, you're right, without me, they'd be screwed, wouldn't they? Ladies and gentlemen, and the Medics, yeah. I suppose I do put the doctor into Doctor and the Medics.
So, Clive, how have you been, man? It's been a while.
Well, you know, I think we all know what's going on. And because that's all going on, I'm not going on. So I'm trying to keep body and soul together without gigging, which is, you know, I'll lay my cards on the table. Everyone who knows me and knows I'm a gigging musician. That's my job. That's what I get paid for. And people kind of sometimes confuse me, I think, with Gary Barlow, because people sort of say, oh, you'll be all right. You'll be gigging next year. You know, that's really, you know, it's been very difficult to get for me personally, to get from a point of earning a living to having absolutely nothing coming in. But we've turned the corner. We've all got ourselves stable, the band. We're all kind of secure and everything. So we all know what we're doing. And we're using the time to finish our album, which has been in the pipeline for 12 years.
You have, obviously, your album coming out, and you're going to be doing some live streaming. Because I think you're going to put a live stream together, with what I'm hearing correctly. And I think it's going to be put on a link just below here.
This is in Birmingham. It's called Birmingham Stream Live, or Birmingham Live Stream. Sorry, well, check one of them, just Google it. You know what I mean? People say to me now, like, oh, how do we get in touch with you? What's your web address? Oh, for God's sake, just put Doctor and the Medics in on Google and go through about 10 results and you'll find us. So Birmingham Stream Live, Doctor and the Medics, you'll find us, everybody. It's on July the 4th. And I've got to admit, it was brilliant, because the timing of it for me is fantastic, because I was reaching a point where I said to myself, what I'm going to do is all those jobs in my office that are piling up, all those piles of paper, all that mind clutter that stops you getting out there and, you know, realizing your potential. Hey, you know, I'm going to get all that out of the way. And I'm reaching the point where it's all got out of the way. So it's nice now, because we're starting to do work on the album again, which is fantastic. And I've got rid of all the head clutter. And then this show comes on. So we've now got something to focus on that is Doctor and the Medics, as opposed to looking at the news, to doing projections of, well, if they get a vaccine here and they do everybody there, will this gig here happen? Will that gig? You know, I've given up. I have actually said to myself, if I do a gig this year.
We talked a little bit about sort of, you know, what you'd be looking forward to, getting the streaming together on July the 4th. Getting together and doing the gig.
Yeah.
How is it coming together as a band during this time at the moment? In the world like where we're moving to Zoom, you live in, you know, the Brecon, the work, like, so the joys of the education. How are you finding coming together and rehearsing and getting a theme together?
None of us know the answer. Because we haven't done it. We haven't seen each other since we played Pontins, an 80s weekend in March. We did two shows back at the beginning of March before lockdown. And now, we've not even seen it. We do a Zoom meetings with everybody. And here's the rub. We're doing a new song off the album that we've never played before. So we're all kind of on Zoom. We're all going, we'll do this, do that. I'm going down to Dan's on Monday. And we've worked out, he's got his little studio. We've got a socially distanced studio where I'm in one room, he's in the other. So I'm going to do the vocals on the track. And then we're going to send it to the guys and say, learn it. Because next time you play this, you'll be live streaming to I don't know how many thousand people. Not on stage where you can just make a joke of it, but you'll be live streaming the next time you play this. And we won't have played it together. We'll rehearse it during the day. But what I was kind of saying to before, by the way, viewers, if you're watching this, if there is any unsightly editing, it's my fault because I live in the Brecon Beacons in the middle of bloody... going and he keeps stopping to have a drink, okay? So apologies, but what I was saying, for us to actually have something to aim to, and it's not just like going to a gig. This is going to a gig times 10 in terms of logistics. I can't travel in the car with Matt, Dan and Chris and Maria. Aid is high risk. How about that for fun? All right. We're not allowed, when we get in, we're not allowed to actually be within any space of each other. We've got the stages separated by perspex. So for us to do it, it's logistically, but it's great. I can't wait to do it. I'm really excited. It's given me something to focus on in 2 weeks' time. So yeah, please, everybody, if you want to tune in, have a look, because we do a set, then we do an interview in an interview area, and then we do another set. And what we're going to be doing is not what we'd normally do live. We're going to be doing a few covers, but we're going to be doing a lot of our old original material and, of course, a couple of songs from the album. So it will be a little bit different because we realise that, unlike a gig where you've got people bouncing around and jumping and they want to hear what they know, people are looking and watching. And I think it would be more interesting for people to look and watch, to hear us do some stuff that maybe they've never heard us do before. So, yeah, it's a really interesting thing, and I'm really pleased it's happening.
So, happy coincidence that probably on the day that this video is going to drop, your live streaming gig is effectively tonight. So, as people are watching this, it's tonight. So,
that's the doctor's time machine, ladies and gentlemen, working properly.
There we go. So, yeah, like I say, we'll put the link up here again now. So if you want to go on there, I don't know. I believe you've got how much are tickets?
I think it's £5 and you can watch it as many times as you want. But please don't get excited about getting value for money. You won't want to see it again.
Great. So we're going to watch, we're going to put one of your tracks on now. We're going to start with Spirit in the Sky. Before we do, I just want to get a bit of a feel of it from you, take you back to 1986 and sort of have you tell us a bit about it and how it all came about.
Well, you know, it's really funny because, again, the timing of this, because going back to coronavirus, COVID and everything else, which we do, I've put together a one-stroke, two-man show, because before full gigs happen, you can, the chances are you can go into small venues, comedy venues, church halls, village halls, where the seating is on tables. This is kind of what's on the agenda. So I thought, well, that's right, because I saw something ages ago that said comedy clubs. And I thought, well, that's right for the bloody comedians, isn't it? What about us? You know, what about the poor old musicians? Yeah, let's look after them. But then I thought about it and thought, well, of course, because in a club like that, you can have tables and chairs and seating. So I've written a show called The Doctor Will See You Now, Life as a One-Hit Wonder. And it's basically me talking about, it's like an evening with. So it's me talking all the nonsense and all the stories that everything that happened. And in between, and I've got Dan on guitar and backing tracks. And then we're going to play the singles. So you ask about Spirit, and I've been writing bits and thinking about it properly for the first time because I've actually got to have something cohesive in place. And here's the story about Spirit in the Sky. Over the years, so many little myths and legends and strange old stories have sprung up about how and why we did it. Okay. Now, the two front runners, there's two front runners, right? One is an absolute lie and a pile of just fanciful nonsense, right? The other is the truth. If I tell you that the lie is more believable than the truth, right? But I'm not going to tell you which version I'm going to tell you now. I'm going to tell you one of the stories. You don't know if it's the truth or the lie, and I'm not going to tell you. This is why we recorded Spirit in the Sky, right? I had a dream. We'd been in the studio working with Craig Leon and doing the album. We had mucked around with Spirit in the Sky before. And one night I went home from the recording, had a dream. And in that dream, and it's very specific, I met John Lennon and Yoko Ono in Lavenham in Suffolk. Very specific, it was Lavenham in Suffolk. So there we are. I met John and Yoko. Now, what would you do if you met John and Yoko? You'd go in a pub and have a pint, wouldn't you? So I go in this pub with John and Yoko. Now, I can't remember in the dream what Yoko had to drink. I remember John had a pint, I had a pint. I cannot remember what Yoko Ono had, right? I would love to remember that. But anyway, if anybody else was there in my dream, could they let me know? Right. And there in the corner was Mark Bolan playing Spirit in the Sky on acoustic guitar. And I went in the next day and I said to everyone, look, I've just had this dream last night, and they're all taking the mick and everything else. But Craig Leon overheard it and went, you guys should do that. And I went, yay. Now, if you listen to the production of Spirit in the Sky very carefully, we put the Tony Visconti strings from T-Rex in the middle bit, okay? And when I'm singing When They Lay Me Down to Rest, in the 80s, you used to double track, quadruple track, blah, 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 on quite a few of those tracks. I'm rather naughtily singing When They Lay Me Down T-Rex. And if you listen very closely, you can hear it. And that is my tribute to Mark Bolan for telling me in a dream to record Spirit in the Sky. Now, that's the story. Whether that's the true one or the lie, I'm not going to tell you.
It's a great story.
Anyway. Your comments in underneath the video posting as to whether you think that is going to be a truth or a lie. We're sending that back to the doctor after the showing.
So we're going to listen to the track now. Doctor and the Medic, Spirit in the Sky.
Thank you.
Okay, so that was Spirit in the Sky. Clive, I forgot what I was going to say now. We've gone off on
I'll ask you a question for you. You're going to say, so Clive, that was filmed on the set of a film you were in, I believe.
That's the one.
Right, well, I've done it now, so there we are. It was my first film. I would say my first film, but it wasn't. It was my only film, and I'm in it for 2 minutes and 37 seconds. I play a dead 478-year-old Baron. So I've been typecast yet again, called The Howling, and it's out there, and I was in the film. That explains why that's not the usual video, because we were allowed to film that on set, so something a little bit different for all of you. There we are.
So fast forward, 2017, first year Minety Music Festival, we launch it. We don't know what it's going to be like. It's a template. Whether we're going to do it again and again and again, year on, year on. And Doctor of the Medics are the headline act. I'm currently drinking cider at the festival mug, where it actually has Doctor of the Medics still headlining by prized possession. But what I'd love to hear from you, Clive, is your experiences of the festival. The sun was shining, it was beautiful, the crowd. You know, just for you to come and headline meant a lot to us. So what were your experiences of coming to the festival, to Minety, and performing?
Well, it was amazing for us as well to come, because anyone who's seen us before, the band, I think they're going to a state of comatose hibernation when I start this speech on stage at festivals, but I mean it, and I always say, I will keep saying it, and I will keep saying it, because it's important, and I think it's more important now than ever. And that is that festivals are a unifying force. They bring communities, they bring people together, they bring everyone together. We live in very, very divisive times, and especially now, and people are kind of tuning into Twitter and all the social media and all the people trying to politically play us like idiots and pull us apart. But what happens when you get to a festival, same as when you go down the pub, only on a bigger and much better scale, is you go in and you meet people of a different mindset, you talk to them, you have a beer, music bonds us together. And that force is so much more important now than ever before. And what I loved was the fact that you guys had just literally, I think the story was, you went down the pub and just decided to run a festival. Well, absolutely brilliant. And you did it. And to me, that vibe, because you were so, I think, what went across to everyone there was the honesty. We're honest about what we do. You're honest about what we do. There's no flowering it up. You're not making yourselves out to be anything, you know. And what happened on that night, as you say, the sun was shining, and I think everyone just went, ah.
Yeah.
And we all went into this mode, and it was a beautiful, beautiful night. And I have been watching you from afar. Yeah. I have been stalking you. Yeah, no, over the years since. And, you know, for me to see how you're doing has been an absolute joy. You deserve it. Everyone who goes deserves it, because what I like about it is it's not us and them. It's everybody at a festival. We're all in the same field. If it's muddy, we're all muddy. If it's rainy, we're all wet. If it's sunny, we're all dry. It breaks those barriers and it gets us together. So you've done brilliantly, and I can't wait. I can't wait. Am I allowed to say it?
Go on, do it. It's all yours. The floor is yours.
Am I allowed to say it? I cannot wait to get back next year, because we're playing in 2021. Yeah! I said it. Woo! Yeah. Good. So there we are. No, so that'll be 89, 20. That'll be 4 years after we first played, and we can't wait to get back. So,
So listen, next year, if I have my facts right, there's a little secret as well about next year, on two little secrets, actually, if you want to share. One, it's a special year for you. I think there's a big date coming up around that kind of period. And secondly, if I'm right, 2021 rolls in a couple of decades after the inauguration of Dr. the Medic, am I right, back in 1981. So 40 years on, is that right?
39 years, yeah, that was 82. Yeah, that was 82. However, it will be 86 to 21 is how many years?
35.
It will be 35 years since Spirit in the Sky was number one. Blimey. But the other one you alluded to is, what date is it? What can we give the date now for?
Yeah, so it's the 2nd to the 4th of July next year.
Yeah, 2nd to 4th of July. So when we play 3 days later, I will be 60.
Hey! Yeah. Right, birthday celebration.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so is this any way for a 60-year-old to behave, I ask you?
Wouldn't have it any other way, though, would you?
No. Well, look, after everything I've gone through to get to here, yeah, no, quite. So trust me, and especially after this year, I would just say to everyone, if you want to come, please, please come and celebrate life, love, music. And if you're there at the time, it'll be near my 60th birthday. It'll be a very special night.
We're going to hear another track from you now. We're going to hear originally recorded by Dead or Alive, You Spin Me Round. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that, please?
Well, yeah, we'd just started playing it, and there's a relationship with me and Pete Burns. We never met. I don't think he was a fan. I think that's fair to say. However, what rubbed him up the wrong way more than anything, I think, was the fact that people used to mistake me for him. They never mistaked him for me, right? I'm the one who should be upset, to be honest, right? People used to get upset for me. And I don't think that went down very well. However, that did change. As he changed his look and everything else, I no longer got compared to him. I then got compared to Roy Wood on regular occasions. Oh, look, it's Roy Wood. You know, God knows who I'd get compared to now, but you know, maybe for once, just myself would be nice, right? We'd been playing that song live, and it was a complete tribute because I thought, do you know what? I was a fan of his. I loved his attitude. I loved everything he did, and I loved the song. So we've been playing it for a while, and I suddenly realised that the band who'd been with me since 1999, Johnny and everyone, they'd never had that experience of holding a piece of vinyl in your hands that's yours, that you're back, that you've made. I thought, well, they've never done it. So we recorded it. We liked it. And I thought, oh, come on, let's do a video. And we were the last people to ever do anything in the 12 Bar Club in Denmark Street in London. It closed down as a venue. And I think the week after we did it, it was demolished. Legendary venue. So for us to do it there was a little bit special as well. And so I did this as an absolute tribute and a thank you to some of the most amazing people in my life, people who've got me through some very hard times. They've got me through the last 20 years, certainly plus 20 years and counting. And those people are, and the Medics, as we said before, my band. They're absolutely fantastic. So this I did so that they could have a video done, they could have that vinyl, and it's a massive thank you from me to them for being such amazing people.
Do you want to go ahead and introduce it for us then?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is And the Medics with the Doctor playing You Spin Me Round.
Watch out, here I come. Yeah.
So that was Doctor and the Medics. You spin me round. Welcome back, Clive.
Yeah, I was gonna drop in that lovely warm up that you did round the back of the stage. And I don't know whether it's shortened or longer, or will get longer going into next year. I do recall listening to a la 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 la. Is that a regular thing for you?
It depends how I'm feeling. It depends if my voice feels fine, I don't bother. You know, I just go out and sing and it's fine. But if I'm feeling, I think, oh God, and I know, you know, after years of singing, and I've lost my voice on stage quite a few times, and it's not a nice thing to happen. If you warm it, it's a muscle. It's a very powerful little muscle, tiny little, very powerful muscle. And if you don't warm it up, and it's, you know, yeah, but if you warm it up, you can get more out of it. So we do it because simply, I don't, you know, and I'll do it in the middle of a field, everyone going, oh, look at him, prima donna, you know, me, 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 you know, all that. But I do it because I know what it feels like to lose your voice on stage. And I hate that feeling. And talking of that, we're doing this thing on the 4th. We haven't played since the beginning of March. So we have literally, the only place I can go without people telling me to shut up is in my car. So I've now worked out, I've got a vocal exercise on Spotify. From the moment I leave my house to the moment I pull up outside the co-op to do my essential socially distanced shopping, I can get the entire range of vocal exercises in. So I've been trying to keep myself singing, because otherwise you're going to go out after months, and especially as an older guy, after months of not singing, and go, and I hate it. It's a horrible thing to do. So yeah, we do that, and yeah, it's for a reason.
I've got to say that the people that pull up next to you on traffic lights must look across and wonder what the hell's going on.
It's worse than that. The last exercise, if everything goes according to plan, the very last exercise is in the co-op of the car park of the co-op in Brecon. So I'm sitting in the car park going, you know, people just walking past the car, so it's funnier than traffic lights. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to finish up with some quick fire questions. Okay. One of the themes we've been carrying through this series of interviews is been asking people their kind of top five fantasy league bands that they would have at a festival. So it could be, you know, money's no object. They could be dead. They could be alive. They could be together, not together. Who would you have in your list? Who would be your lineup?
Right. Well, I remember you asked me this while I got off my bike and I was having my shower, and I thought, oh, bloody hell. So, and I think I've got four, and I'll make up the other one on the spot. Okay. I would have, and this is not necessarily musical taste. This is as your festival band. So, I would have headlining Motorhead.
Yep.
Then I would have The Damned supporting. Then I would have the X-Ray Specs. Ah, yeah, X-Ray Specs. And then before that, I would have Hawkwind.
Okay.
Now, but I would only have the Hawkwind playing Space Ritual, the entire Space Ritual, as they did at Wembley, right? That's my favourite live album. So I would have Hawkwind playing Space Ritual. And then as an opening act, not a lot of people will know this, I would have Rocky Erickson, who I saw, he's died now, but I saw him, he was an idol of mine. Yep, everyone, someone for everyone to go onto Google. Check Rocky Erickson, the 13th floor elevators. He's one of my idols since I was very young, and I did actually get to see him about a year before he died. Phenomenal voice. Sadly, he had the whole electrodes to the brain because he was arrested for drugs and they tried to pass him off as insane. A hell of a life story. So there we are. I would have him on first.
But craziest festival experience.
Oh, do you know what? That's like one of those questions when someone asks a comedian, go on, be funny then, you know, blimey. I tell you what, it was literally, this isn't the craziest one, but it was a year ago. Maria from the band reminded me 2 days ago. She said, happy anniversary. And I thought, what? She said, it was exactly a year ago today. you bruised your backside. Now, if anyone looks on the Medic's Facebook page, the Medic's logo, it looks like a nice, colourful background. Dan has put the logo on the photo of my arse with the bruise, right? Because the bruise went from the bottom of my back down to the bottom of my leg. She said, it was exactly a year ago today, you fell down a hole in a Scooby-Doo set crack den right? whilst waiting for a bus from a festival. I'm not going to fill in the gaps. You can all work it out. So there we are. And I literally, I could not walk for 3 weeks. I was walking through this abandoned Scooby-Doo set that turned out, we didn't know, the cab was going to be an hour. It was pouring down with rain. So we went in this, not the greatest thing to do, pitch black, your phones as your torches, a derelict building site, a 57-year-old man. What could possibly go wrong?
Brilliant.
You're going to chuckle at this, but one of the other themes that we've been running through this series is who would win in a fight. And before we had this conversation earlier, we picked two for you, one of which was Roy Wood versus Noddy Holder. Who would win?
Oh, do you know what? I think it would go to the referee scoring cards. But I think Noddy would slightly pip it purely.
Oh, we'll never know. We lost him. We lost him. We lost him.
Have you got me again?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, remember I said we might drop out at vital times. We just did. This is me back. Right, I think Roy Wood, Noddy Holder, it would go to the referee's scorecard. I think Noddy might just pitch it. And the only reason I'm saying that is because prior to Slade, just after they became Ambrose Slade, they were a skinhead band. And anyone looks at early photos of them, they were skinheads and they looked a little bit useful. So I would say Noddy might just pip it over Roy.
Brilliant. So at festivals, camping or glamping?
For me, yeah. Neither. I'm off to the nearest luxury hotel nearby, mate. I'm not doing any of them now. We used to camp quite a lot. In fact, up until, I think about 3 years ago, we did a VW festival and we camped. But after doing a gig, getting my body out of a tent needs at least four people and it doesn't look very good. And you see people, oh, there's the doctor with people dragging you by your feet out of a sleeping bag. Doesn't need to be done. No, I can't. My days, sadly, if I'm gigging, love it, hotel. Although there is one festival I compare at and I sleep in a builder's cabin. That's not even glamping, is it?
If you were going to collaborate, who would you collaborate with?
Do you know what? Pete Wiley from the Mighty Wah.
Why is that?
I've just been listening to him a lot. I was looking forward to meeting him because there is a photo of me on the internet and him backstage at Gossips where I used to DJ. And I didn't realise the history of the blues was until recently. I probably remembered at the time, but I forgot, was filmed in the actual club that I started off in, DJing. And it, for me to watch that video is fantastic because you just see around all the club. And there's a video photo of me backstage. He came to one of our nights, maybe that night. I don't know. Someone fill in the gaps, please. There are a lot of them. I'm in my underpants backstage with Pete Wiley looking over my shoulder in the camera. And I thought, I wonder where that came from. And I was looking forward to asking him if he remembered. But no, I'm a big admirer of him and his music. As me.
We lost you again then. Sorry. But yeah, no, seriously, Clive, thanks ever so much for coming on the show. We can't wait to have you back at Minety Music Festival next year.
Absolute
thank you.
Legend.
Thank you. No, it's been lovely. Thank you for having me on. It's been lovely having a chat. This has been my Saturday night out.
Thank you, Clive. What a top bloke. What a top bloke. Well, it's kind of a shame. It's obviously a shame that we can't do it. I think everyone knows the reasons why. So, we're here instead of here. And we're back in the room, as if by magic.
It's an empty field.
It's an empty field. That's where we should be, but we're here.
It's so small. It's such a small field when you look at it. I guess, you know, living in Minety and walking the dog and, you know, through all that kind of area, and you think, oh, you know, there are three marquees, there are stalls, there are circus skills training and events, there is the various different charities, you know, their marquees that are up. And it's just, you know, when you're inside it, it's so big. But when it's all gone, it just looks so small. It's just the transformation is something else.
It's very strange. It's very strange seeing it empty.
Yeah, I don't know if that's a really easy segue, actually, because I know we talked a little bit about, you know, some of the questions we're going to ask. But I think one of the favourite times that you enjoy, and I think it's really special, is the kind of leading up to the event, you know, that week before and that night before the festival kicks off. It's a very special moment, isn't it?
I don't think I'm alone in that, to be fair. I think a lot of the guys that are involved in the setup week, we're a pretty tight-knit family now, and there are, you know, there's probably 20 or so people that help with the integral setup of the festival. And it's a lot of work. It's basically, it takes us a week to set it up. But I love the camaraderie that goes on with that. You know, everyone gets stuck in, gets their hands dirty. You know, if there's anything needs to be done, it gets done. Every night we stop and we have a barbecue or something, have a couple of beers together, sit back and reflect on the day, figure out what we've got to do next day. And there's banter and, you know, Mickey taking all day long. And it's just a really, I enjoy that almost as much as the actual festival itself. And especially on Thursday night, kind of, you know, the festival starts on the Friday. The Thursday night, all of the work is done, or pretty much all of the work is done. And you kind of start to feel the festival come alive. You know, the festoon lights go on. It starts to get dark. There's a few lights and a bit of movement around the site. The guys are sound engineering or checking out the lights on the different stages, and you just kind of get that it's coming alive now. And I love that. That's, for me, that is one of the highlights of the whole festival, is when it starts to come alive on the Thursday night, and you can sit back and think, this is going to be buzzing tomorrow.
I think something's very special about the Friday when it all starts. Cause I kind of, you know, as a compare, okay, I to be honest, I feel a bit of a fraud. I feel I get the glory of do nothing. I just rock up and embarrass myself up on stage, which I very regularly do. But you know, I don't mind it because I'm not being paid. I'm doing it because I love it, and I'm doing it because I'm part of Minety. I'm doing it because it's special. You know, and I'm proud of that. Like, I think everybody is who contributes. You know, and I walk my dog, you know, the week leading up to the event, and there was an army of locals, right? But it's all the locals that are chippy, sparkies, you know, people who could put up marquees, like all the like massive laborers. I always get, oh, Matt, you're going to come down and help? Go, oh, no, my work's cut out. You know, for the 3 days I go to the festival. I've got to keep my voice, which I always lose on the last day.
Next year.
Oh, I'm not going to see it through. Third day I've had it, 'cause I'll just shout. That's my problem.
I want to cut in just for a second and just apologise for my shonky interview skills and editing, because I'm not used to doing this. I'm not Chris Moyles. This has been cobbled together in about a week and a half, 2 weeks.
And you've pulled me along for the ride as well, which has been another experience and added to your woes throughout. So what you thought was magnificent interviewing experience, I'm afraid I oversold on that one.
I'll tell you what.
I'm delighted to be a part of it.
Right. One thing I do want to say as well is I need to offer special thanks to the tribe for being so patient with me as we went through about a 40-minute interview with them, only to realise that I hadn't pressed record at the start and we had to do the whole thing again. So those guys, Ant and AJ, thanks so much, mate. And I'm so sorry once again, because we basically did the whole interview twice.
Yeah, and let's not forget some people that live in remote areas as part of the world as well, where Zoom doesn't necessarily work as well as what it should do with a better Wi-Fi connection. So there was a lot of...
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And can I just put a note out as well? It was not his daughter that stole the Wi-Fi in his house, which could ruin the Zoom. It was generally just Zoom freezing. So I think we're all good there.
So next up, we've got a couple of tracks that have been recorded especially for Minety Music Festival by Charlie Ann from Young Vintage. They would have been playing this year. Instead, they're playing next year. So I will hand over to her.
Hello, everyone watching from Minety Music Festival. I hope you're all safe and well. My name's Charlie. I am from the band called Young Vintage. We are so excited that we've been asked to play for you again next year. But for now, it's just me. I'm going to do a couple of my own songs for you. One of them's called Phase, and the other one is called Bottle Over Me. I'm the queen of awkward intros, so I'm going to keep this quite short. But make sure that you stay safe so that we can see you all again next year. Bye! Love you still. do. Oh my God. Take your hand off of the bottle and put it on my waist. I would stomp right out this cigarette, but these shoes won't go to waste. And I'm sucking up the smoke and I'm breathing in the atmosphere.
So that was Phase and Bottle Over Me by Charlie Ann from Young Vintage. Thanks ever so much for recording that for us. And we will see you next year.
If they won't come to the festival, we'll bring the festival to them, brother. Play my tunes in the festival when nobody's here. I got car keys in my guitar case and I play with no fear.
Our first song is off our debut album Dropout Zone and it's called Nighttime Is the Right Time.
Down!
there's a lot of bands that right now can't play at events. To have them as part of the virtual festival, you know, to be able to like sort of play some of their music, absolutely brilliant. And we're absolutely delighted to have the Roving Crows, you know, playing some music for us that we want to share with you now. So listen, hey, give it up, the Roving Crows.
I'm giving up this city, leaving it all behind for a wild Atlantic woman and some peace of mind. You won't find me online. I'm picking up the pen. I'm giving up this city for some Donegal's end. She has mischief in her eyes and her hair curls in the rain. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, all your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, all your West Coast will be free. She asked if she could join me. We blew away that bar. I was living in a shoebox in the shadow of Big Ben. She said, give up the city for some Donegal's end. Walking over Tower Bridge, her hair curled in the rain. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, all your West Coast will be free. Monday morning, the sirens fighting crime. She said, there's a corner of the universe, you'll get lost in time. Sing from your soul, you'll be a big star when you give up this city for some Donegal's end. As we loaded up my van, her hair curled in the rain. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free. Wild Atlantic woman, taking care of me. Wild Atlantic woman, on your West Coast will be free.
So obviously, a lot of charities are suffering too within the lockdown. So one of the things I wanted to do was to set up my own personal Just Giving page. So hopefully that will be up and running by the weekend. So if you like it, give some money and it's going to be split between the charities. Obviously, we've got five charities that or five causes, I should say, that we support. So we would have been giving money to Wiltshire Air Ambulance, Naimi House Hospice and Jack's Place, Combat Stress, the Big Yellow Bus Project and Minety Community Shop Project. With everything that's going on at the moment, obviously they're suffering more than a lot of people. So I wanted to do something. This isn't to do with the festival or anything like that. This is me personally. So we'll try and put the link up so that if anyone feels like donating to it, it'd be very much appreciated. But it'd be great. I'd love to be able to raise $2,500 so we can give each of the charities 500 quid. So if you can help, then please do.
So any contribution that you are able to provide out of this will be, you know, heartily received by all the charities where the money is going to. Operating, particularly right now as well, when charities are suffering massively through the lack of events and festivals like ours that generate a lot of the revenue for them. So thank you, and please do donate where you can on the link that will be provided.
Yeah, we're basically going to put something on our Facebook page, so it'll be all across the Minety Music Festival Facebook pages. So if you're able to give a little bit of money, be very much appreciated. Thank you ever so much.
We are there with really poorly people who are at their worst moment in their lives, potentially. For that moment, they're my family, so that patient is my world. There's a real emotional investment as well as a clinical one. That person's probably going to remember that day forever. And although we see these patients far too frequently, unfortunately, for them, that's the one moment that they've got of Wiltshire Air Ambulance.
It's a powerful, fast aircraft. We can go up to 155 knots with that. So that's about 170, 180 miles an hour. And obviously, if you can get a 30-mile-an-hour wind behind you, which is quite possible, we can be up sort of 3 miles a minute across the ground.
No 2 days are the same. We might come in and see traumatic patients or cardiac patients. They're all very different. We need to raise £3.75 million a year, which is about £10,000 a day, to provide our care. And we can only do this because of the generosity of the businesses and the members of the public who put on fundraising events and provide us with that funding.
Ready? Yeah. And move.
Everybody gets it. They all get that the air ambulance is something that they might need, their son or daughter might need, their mother or father might need. And it doesn't matter who you are, what you look like, what you believe in, the air ambulance is a vital service for everybody, and everybody completely understands that. It's very much a part of civil society here in Wiltshire.
Once a task comes in, what will happen is the pilot will then go out to the aircraft, start it up, while the clinicians are plotting where the incident is, and then we will make our way towards the aircraft, and off we go to that incident. So we can be in the air from the moment that call comes into us within about 2 minutes, less than 2 minutes, and then we can be on the side of the road within Wiltshire in about 11 minutes, offering the critical care service that we offer.
This is not funded by the government, wasn't set up by the government in the first place. It's kind of like the RNLI of the air. And we rely entirely on the people of Wiltshire to fund this service.
As it says on the side of the machine, it's funded by you, flying for you. And it really is that every penny that's donated is a penny used towards treating that patient.
So next up, we've got a full interview with Talk in Code, and hopefully we're going to listen to a little bit of their music as well.
I'm joined now by Chris from Talk in Code. Chris, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Good to see you, Rich. Yeah, very well, thank you. Very well.
Good. Are you keeping busy? Have you been affected by the lockdown?
Yeah, well, I mean, we've all been affected probably in one way or another, to be honest. You know, with, especially obviously on the band front, we've just tried to do as much as we can, staying active, doing loads of online stuff, and just trying to keep busy that way with things. But you know, in my personal life, I've been quite fortunate not to have been impacted perhaps as majorly as others. So grateful in that sense.
So have you had many gigs cancelled through the summer, or did you have some festivals lined up already?
Yeah, we have, unfortunately. So we had a pretty big gigging and festival season of around 15 shows in all that have been cancelled across festivals and just sort of general gigs and stuff. So taking quite a big hit, which is a massive shame. And like many artists in the same position, it's a real shame that those shows have had to be cancelled. It's just nothing you can do about it, especially in that we had release plans and we've put quite a bit of music out and planned on supporting it with a lot of live shows. It's just a shame it's turned out that way. But hey, you just got to stay positive and make the most of a bad situation.
How have you guys found it in terms of rehearsing as a band, obviously with isolation and whatnot? Have you managed to kind of keep busy and do anything whereby you've done any kind of recording projects where you've done stuff from different houses and that kind of thing, or have you managed to actually kind of get together and rehearse in a garden or something like that? So.
Well, to be honest, I've been quite impressed with how many bands have been able to put stuff up that's kind of like a whole band effort that they've cobbled together. We haven't quite got ourselves in gear, I don't think, well enough to do that. So we haven't got together physically, for one. Two, we haven't really been able to get together. We've had a few Zoom calls and like chats and catch-ups and stuff, but in terms of playing music all together, we haven't really been able to do that. Instead, I've just been playing quite a bit and putting some sort of one-off acoustic type performances just out online on our Facebook and stuff, called backseat sessions, literally from the backseat of my car.
I've seen just one or two of these.
just a bit of fun, playing a few songs. And what, as a result of that, I think we got invited to play the rockathon for the NHS to support to raise funds for the coronavirus sort of support effort at Great Western Hospital. It's winning through a charity called Brighter Futures. So that was really good. So that was great to be a part of. So one of those backseat sessions was a performance for that. So that was really good. But no, nothing really as a whole band, just doing stuff that we can acoustically and playing and having chat sessions with fans and stuff, but nothing really as a whole band.
It's kind of difficult, isn't it? Because I mean, I guess there's a lot of bands currently that are gonna probably have to spend 2 or 3 months kind of getting back up to speed.
Yeah, definitely. Ourselves will be included in that, no doubt. You know, we're trying to be disciplined with doing some rehearsing at home, but it's not the same as getting together as a whole band. I think, you know, you just, like you said, getting sort of back up to, you know, match fitness, as we call it. You only really do that through playing shows and rehearsing and getting real tight together. And we reached a point after all of our gigs and our string of shows that we played last year, we got to a point where we were really sort of happy with our live show and we're performing really well and we felt strong. We were really buzzing to get into the festival season this year, and COVID hit and that was that kind of thing. But yeah, we'll be getting back into the rehearsal room and practicing hard, getting up to speed, ready to hit the shows again.
So how did the band actually get started then? Who's in it? Tell us a bit about you guys.
Yeah, sure. So at the moment, the lineup, we're a four-piece. So myself, Chris, vocals and some rhythm guitar. Got a lead guitarist and programmer, synth program called Al Snedden, or Sneds. Bass, guitar and programming, Titch, or Mark Turner. And we've also got Jamie or Jambo as our drummer. So we've been playing together. Jamie's been with us for nearly 2 years now. Myself, Titch and Sneds have been playing together for getting towards sort of 6 years, I would say, from we put our first record out together. But prior to that, there was something like a precursor of Talking Code, a previous incarnation that had quite Americana-type roots. But when myself, Sneds and Titchell started working together and writing together with another synth player at the time, we started to really kind of unearth and discover that kind of synth orientated sound more, and bring a lot of kind of more dance element into our tracks whilst keeping true to sort of the live instrumentation. So the blend became really interesting with how we then sort of pursued. Five, 6 years we've been playing together now, loads of shows. We put our first record out in 2014, self-titled debut album, Talking Code. And then our next album came out in 2018 called Resolve. We put a couple of EPs out and stuff in between. And then just recently, we've put a few singles out as well, just in sort of silo, maybe with the view for a third album or an EP as well. But that's kind of a quick sort of canter through. We write in terms of our sort of writing process. We all make contribution to that. We all write ideas in our own way, whether it be me on a vocal melody and acoustic, or one of the guys coming to the table with a synth or guitar riff. You know, we bring it to the table and say, you know, do you think this has got legs? Yeah, great. Let's put some meat on the bones. Let's start to structure it out and build it up into a whole song. So that's sort of like the general feel of things. Yeah.
What I've heard of your sound recently is very far from Americana roots.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, was that a natural transition, or did it just kind of happen over time? Or
yeah, I mean, when I to go further back, I played drums for about 12 years in all, and I was in a band back then. That was my first sort of proper band, if you like, or when I really started to get seriously involved in music. And that was quite Americana driven. There's a band called The Hour. We were quite Americana driven. And I'd always been into bands like Matchbox 20, Counting Crows, the Goo Goo Dolls, Ryan Adams, these kind of artists and stuff really inspired me. And I think that I naturally went towards that. But then when that chapter of Talking Code sort of disbanded, if you like, when I started working with Tips and Eds and we grew from there, that was where we started to really kind of discover and unearth a lot of the synth stuff that we were really into. And we don't shy away from our music being accessible. And so it's got like, that's really where it came from, just experimenting with different sounds and wanting to contemporize our sound, I think.
I mean, obviously in a band, come on, you have to share the goods then. Rock and roll stories from your band, there's got to be a couple.
Oh my god, well I could probably we're much more likely to have a cup of tea.
This is a family audience, by the way, so
yeah, well that's what I'm gonna say, you know. We're much more likely to have a cup of tea and put our feet up after a show than we are to go and party hard, get steaming drunk and one thing and another, you know. None of us are smokers, none of us are really sort of big drinkers. I'm just trying to think. I mean, it's probably more like stories. I don't know, we're a bit boring, I think, in that sense. rock and roll stories, not a great deal. I mean, I did one I will share with you. We've been quite fortunate to play with some fairly good names at different festivals.
Elaborate.
This particular festival, we're on the same bill as a band called Embrace. Some people may be familiar with Embrace. They were pretty big sort of throughout the 90s. I was a really big fan, and Danny McNamara, the front man and singer from Embrace, was a big fan of. We're on the same bill as them. We were like two slots before them. And when they arrived, I just sort of like, oh my God, that's Danny McNamara. I'm just sort of like fangirl moment. And like, I haven't lived it down since from the rest of the band. So that was quite amusing. Our promotions manager, she got locked in trying to get out of a festival early when the gates are closed. That was a bit of a shenanigan. So we've just had more sort of more like just fun things like that kind of stuff happen, really, rather than anything too strong in rock and roll. Like you say, it's a family audience, so you've got to keep a lid on these things.
So we're going to listen to one of your tracks now and play the video. Do you want to tell us a little bit about it, sort of how it was written, where you recorded it, and talk about the video as well?
Definitely. So we're going to play a song called Keep Safe. This was a track that we actually recorded and included on our album, our Resolve album, back in 2018. We put a couple of sort of fun videos and bits and pieces up with it at the time, but obviously how things have come around, it was quite apparent that with COVID-19, that people started using this term, keep safe, to one another, as sort of like a passing comment. Like, oh, okay, so that really interested us. And then with that, our photographer, Helen, who is a massive Lego fanatic, by the way, she did this really fun little stock frame clip of our bassist, Titch. He's a big fan of the water. He's got a jet ski. That sounds a bit grandiose. But anyway, she did this little stock frame animation of him being chased by a shark with Lego figures. Like, oh, ping, you know, there's the idea, there's the spark. So did she fancy taking on the challenge of doing a stock frame Lego animation for a video? So we set to work on the idea of it being a typical day out for Talking Code, and then a typical day out of a festival show. So we did all the pre-bit before that, and then it includes actually a festival performance from the band as well. So it's amazing. She's done such a good job, and we've got loads of traction. I think we're up to about 10k views, and it's only been out a week. So
I've seen the video, and she's clearly got far too much time on her hands, but she's done a fantastic job. So do you want to introduce it for us?
Yeah, this is called Keep Safe.
There's nothing I want more than to tell you you're beautiful. Unless you'd rather be somewhere else than lay here next to me. You could reach out and take it all. Keep safe, everything that I've told you, and do not delay making your move. I'm just about to find my way.
Keep Safe by Talking Code. Welcome back, Chris. So tell us a bit about your festival experiences then. I mean, what's your favourite festival?
What, ones that we've played?
Yeah, favourite festival, yeah. And, you know, festival experiences, your best gigs, your band highlights, I guess.
Yeah, sure. Where to start? I mean, we've been quite fortunate by all accounts as far as some of the gigs and the slots that we've been booked for. One big highlight for me was last year, we played the first ever M4 Festival over at Lydia Park. And we were the first band. We opened the main stage. So we were the first band to play on the main stage for the first ever M4 Festival. So that was kind of a real sort of feather in the cap and making our own little bit of history. The show went really well and we were really, really well received. And we were set to play again this year. So, but once again, that's cancelled. So that was a real moment. We've also played a festival called the Walled Garden Music Festival in Sussex, and the promoter there was a big fan of our music, and we got booked to play. We played for 2 years on the trot. The first year we played with Go West, Mark Almond and Nick Kershaw, which was really cool. And the year after, I just touched on earlier in the chat as well, there was Embrace and Top Loader on the bill. So that was really cool playing with those guys as well. So that they go down as a highlight. Witchwood Festival, we've enjoyed. I think we've played that two or three times. So, you know, we really enjoy playing festivals. They're easy to gear-wise, you know, loading in and out, that sort of thing. Generally get really well looked after. So they've been some real highlights, I think, for us as a band. As far as other shows are concerned, what was pretty cool is we supported a band called Catfish and the Bottlemen a few years ago now. Okay. Just as they were literally about to go through the roof, we played with them at the O2 Academy in Oxford. So support slot with them, that was really cool. It would have been good to latch onto their coattails and go with them on the way up, you know what I mean? But then we couldn't see them for dust after that. So, you know, no, fair play to them. They were great then. I met Van backstage, really nice guy, gave us all the time in the world, really nice chat. So that was cool. There have been loads, you know. We've played in Bristol quite a bit. Some of our Swindon shows, obviously where we're from, it was well attended. So there've been loads. It's hard to sort of pin down.
Any personal favourite or?
Yeah, I think the Walled Garden Festival for me, and I think M4 last year were probably the two that I have enjoyed the most. Very closely followed by Witchwood, which was the year before. Played there a couple of times. So yeah, a couple of real special ones. Probably two or three I think really stand out, and their festivals, because the vibe at a festival is just amazing, you know. So I think for me the festivals are the ones that really stand out, and the ones that I enjoy, and the ones we've got had a really good reception from the crowd from.
So one of the themes that we're looking to basically carry through a lot of these interviews is asking people what would be their top five festival bands. Imagine playing fantasy league football, but with bands. We're trying to pick people's brains and see, if money was no object, who would you have? You've got an open checkbook.
What can that include? Any bands that are not together anymore?
Ooh, what you mean? Bands where they've croaked, or?
Well, either or. Yeah, you're like your kind of legends list. You know,
musical,
what I mean?
Differences.
Yeah. All right. So
Go for it. Just, you got carte blanche. Get Mozart.
Carte blanche. All right. So I think I'd be kind of really turning towards bands that have had, you know, a massive sort of influence on me. And I've thought to myself, I want to do that. You know what I mean? That those bands, you hear their music or you've seen them live and it's like, wow. I think The Killers would be the first one I'd have to say. Absolutely love The Killers, and Hot Fuss was an album for me that really, I think it was way before its time, but just song after song, you know, starts, I think Jenny Was a Friend of Mine, and it just, Mr. Brightside, somebody told me, it's like, whoa, my goodness, it was so well produced, and it was just a fantastic record, so they'd be right up there. Counting Crows, Adam Duritz, the singer from Counting Crows, is a bit of a hero of mine lyrically. His lyrics, especially for From August and everything after their first record, just absolutely blew me away. My favourite song of all time is a track called Round Here by Counting Crows.
Funnily enough, that's Counting Crows are on my list, and August and Everything After is probably my favourite album of all time. So
you're
in good company there. So I love that.
Well, it's right up there with mine. I think it would be in my top five for favourite albums of all time. Just the delicacy and the blend of the songs and the production on that record is just beautiful.
We saw them at Newport Centre a few years back, and we also saw them at Flower Festival in Finsbury Park, and they are absolutely fantastic live. So you've got my vote on that one. So
So coming back to the point about bands that are not around, or at least not together at the moment or anymore, Oasis would be on there for me. Kind of growing up in the 90s, I think Oasis was sort of, you know, whether it was Blur, Oasis, whatever, or they were kind of the band for me. And I just, something about Liam's swagger and the energy. I saw them live twice, and I've never been to a gig where I've seen the front man or a band literally having the crowd eating out of the palm of their hand. The adoration for that guy was just palpable. It was right at their peak. So, and for that, I was like, I want to be up there playing. So Oasis for me were a band for that reason. You know, the songs, of course, as well, but that's a moment that sticks in my mind. Again, musical influences, U2 are right up there for me. I got into them quite late. I think it was sort of 2001 for sort of All That You Can't Leave Behind. So yeah, beautiful day and so forth. The songs from there, and then on from there, you know, Elevation all the others. So you two would be right up there from me. And then in looking at sort of maybe some of the more contemporary, I haven't seen, and I really want to see the 1975 live. Okay. They're a band that have sort of contributed to our sound in some respects, especially their singles. I'm a bit of a sucker for a single, it's got to be said. But I think that they've been, as modern pop bands go, they've been amazing, and what they've achieved, I have a lot of respect for.
I'm sure someone will correct me, but I've got a funny feeling that they might have played at Fieldview a few years back, kind of when they were on their way up, I guess.
Really?
I believe so. But I might be corrected and put in my place over that one, because I wasn't actually there. So yeah.
But they'd be my five, just kind of thinking about it off the cuff.
As a musician, who would you most like to collaborate with then, as a band?
We'd all have different answers to that question as a band, I think. But as far as songwriting is concerned, obviously Adam Duritz would be one. But I think I'd say, although they're not on my festival list, and my five for festivals, Chris Martin would be someone that I'd like to, especially the more recent Coldplay stuff, you know, Head Full of Dreams, Adventure of a Lifetime, or Milo Zaloto, the stuff they've been putting out recently that is more, again, more dancey, a bit more, it's not dreary, is it? You know, I know that they may have had a reputation previously around Parachutes and Rush of Blood to the Head, where people say, oh, depressing, blah, 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 but it's not the case.
I was going to say, from what I've heard of your sound, Adventure of a Lifetime is kind of on a similar-ish sort of vibe to some of your stuff, so I think that would fit quite well. So
thank you. And I think that, you know, if whatever angle you take with Coldplay, you can't knock the diversity and the aptitude that they've shown for moving with the times. And I think for that reason, you know, they're obviously a real talented band, so that would be pretty awesome. And Avenger of a Lifetime, that was definitely a track that around the time when we've been producing our music more recently, that is a track we've referenced and been like, yeah, this has really got something. So yeah, for sure.
Excellent. A couple of final quick fire questions then. Camping or glamping?
Well, I'd have to say glamping, and the lads would probably agree.
You enjoy the finer things in life.
Yeah, well, it's like, you know, I have this conversation all the lot, and you know, the lads rib me for it. I've got no issue with camping and slumming it after a show, but if it was like we arrived the day before, you know, the first thing, if I'm tired or I've had a bad night's sleep, the first thing that gets affected seems to be my voice. And so I'd be like, oh, you know, I'd be thinking about that too much, and I probably wouldn't sleep as a result. And then, like, you know, getting up and that, not having the facilities around to have a good wash and brush up pre-show, I think I'd struggle with.
So just to get political for a second then, who would win in a fight, Trump or Boris?
Well, Boris, no brainer. He is. I think he moves quicker. He's definitely got the edge on agility over Donald Trump. That's for sure. He's quicker across the ground, mate. I reckon he's got a mean jab.
Okay, beer or cider?
Beer every time. Definitely a lager man, mate. Again, I'll get ribbed for that by the boys, but lager. Bring on the gassiness.
Football or rugby?
Football. Yeah, football. Football's another big passion in my life outside of music. I play just recreational now, but I've played at a reasonable level. But I coach as well, so that's one thing that unfortunately has been disrupted. I played rugby for a few years, but of the two, football would be my choice. Yeah.
Good. Right, we're going to listen to another one of your songs now and see the video.
Awesome.
Can you tell us a little bit about it, introduce it, and tell us what it's all about?
I certainly can, yeah. So this is a song that we were fortunate enough to shoot the video just before COVID landed. The track's called Talk Like That. It's got plenty of energy about it. You know, real good sort of pounding beat, uplifting, and I hope you enjoy it.
So Talk Like That by Talking Code.
Exactly. Stop me dead.
So that was a Talk Like That by Talking Coda. Chris, thanks ever so much for coming on and joining us. Have a great rest of your summer. Hopefully you can find time and we can all get out at some point and get in a field again. But yeah, thanks for your time.
Yeah, I hope so, Rich. Thanks for your time as well. Take care. See you soon.
And this next song is Primal Rhythm by Arcadia Roots.
Changing faces, places surrounding me. Oh, and all I feel are the cold hands of time on my shoulders pushing. Gotta tell me just how far, just how low.
Awesome. Primal Rhythm, Arcadia Roots. Thank you.
So obviously there are a lot of bands doing lockdown sessions, and here's one which has been recorded by Splat the Rat. So
bring it on, Splat the Rat.
A quarter of the world's population is now living under some form of lockdown.
We are collectively telling pubs, bars and restaurants to close and not to open tomorrow.
You should now only go out when absolutely necessary for food, medicine, work or exercise.
More than 3 billion people in almost 70 countries and territories have been asked to stay at home.
We should take comfort that while we may have more still to endure, better days will return. We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
Wish I was a fisherman, swimming on the sea, far away from the dry land and its bitter memories, casting out my sweet life with a band of mountain love. No ceiling bearing down on me, save starry skies above. Light of my hair, you in my arms. Hey, hey, hey. Brakeman on a hurtling fever train, crash to the heartland like a cannon in the rain, with the beating of the sleepers, the burning of the cold. Countless towns are flashing by in a night that's full of soul. Light of my head, you in my arms. Hey, hey, hey. Chains hung all around me, for the way you last. On a fine and fateful day, I will take me in my hands. I will ride on the train. I will be that official man. Light in my head, you in my arms. Hey, 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 hey.
And that was Splat the Rat. So next up, we have The Hallows.
Yeah, they did the main support slot on the Saturday night supporting Neville Staple in 2018.
And Rich caught up with them last week. And this is how it went.
So we welcome The Hallows now to Minety Music Festival Virtual. Hello, guys. How are you doing?
Hello.
Yeah, good, thanks.
So, Dave, tell us how you guys managed to get together in the first place, then. Tell us a bit about the history of the band.
Well, we go a long way back, unfortunately. We're older than we look, except for me. We met originally all at university, so we all studied music together between, Christ, what was it, 2003, 2006 in London, studying on our respective instruments, so drums for me, for Joe, bass for me, Sarah, vocals. We ended up at various stages throughout uni living together as well, and then we performed in various different bands together, different iterations with other great musicians around the place. But then sort of after university, went a separate ways for a little bit for, you know, just the stuff that happens with life, jobs and moving houses and traveling and all that. And then I think it was probably, was it about 2014, correct if I'm wrong, guys, we kind of reconvened to work on some material that Sarah had been writing, and it kind of sprung from there, really. Sarah can probably elaborate more than I can on where that material came from originally, but I think that's kind of where it started.
Yeah, it's pretty much spot on.
Yeah, we'd always worked really well together, and we were always coming back to each other musically. I think together as a three, we, you know, it's like a music magnet. So I think we come, you know.
Or a curse, some might put it. Who knows?
Yeah, it's been really good. It's been really fun. A little bit like a little family unit that bumbles around the country. And
So
how does your writing process work then? Is there one person in particular that brings an idea to everyone else, and or does it just kind of happen organically in rehearsals? How you know?
It depends on the track, doesn't it? Really.
Yeah. We've got some tracks that I've started, and then the guys have added their things to it. We've got some tracks where me and Joe have sat down with an acoustic guitar and wrote some bits together and brought Dave in. Dave's thrown some bass riffs to us and we've worked with those. So it's very, as Dave says, song to song. It's quite organic and different. I think you just got to take the inspiration as and when it comes and work with it and roll with it.
I have to give Sarah 100% of credit for all the lyrics, though, because if I had any responsibility for that, it would not be good at all.
It would be that rock here, wouldn't it, Dave?
Probably, yeah.
Oh, yes, maybe one day we'll get that jingle endorsement.
Yeah, and then you'd still be useful, Dave, I tell you.
So we're going to listen to one of your tracks now. Do you want to introduce it for us, Joe?
Yes, certainly. This one is Cardboard Love, and the video, if you want a little bit of insider knowledge, the man who has his soul sucked out of his body is actually my dad. So there you go. Suffering for your art.
So, Cardboard Love by The Hallows.
Drop a drop, I drink again.
So Of Time and Tides came out in 2016. So are you guys working on new material now?
Can I answer?
Yeah, I'll be good.
We've been writing towards our second album. We've been in the studio. We've got 4 songs already recorded. We've got a music video already ready for one of the tracks. So it's just trying to make sure that we've got all our kind of pieces of the jigsaw in place at the moment. I think with everything that's going on, we've been speaking with other bands, too, everyone's in the same position of just trying to work out timings, really. We've still got string arrangements to write for some of our songs, and then we're still in the process of kind of really piecing together the second half of the album. So it's good, though. We're really enjoying it. It's going to take quite a different tone, I think, to album one, although there is going to be some similarities in terms of perhaps the pop sentimentality, but there's definitely, it's going to be a bit harder edged as well.
Yeah.
I think what's been really cool is that some of the stuff came together for album two pretty quick, and we've been able to get it out live, obviously before lockdown and the rest, and what we've played so far seems to be being received really, really nicely. So we're confident we've got a good second album on our hands.
Yeah, well, I think so actually we did actually play some of the songs from album two at Minety last year. So some of the more kind of riffy guitar stuff, that's album two, and some of the stuff we're going to be releasing.
You did the first Minety, and I think you played on the Friday night, was it? And then you came back and did the main support slot for us. So how was that?
That was amazing.
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Fantastic festival. Really friendly, good food, brilliant sound, great stage. You know, you really put together something quite special. And we really, really look forward to coming back.
We can't wait to have you back. What would you say your probably biggest highlight of the band's career has been to date?
Meeting Sir Ian McKellen was the definite highlight. Definitely had a little bit of...
was cool.
Yeah.
We played a Pride kind of festival. Where was it?
Wigan.
In Wigan, yeah.
Wigan.
And we literally got to go straight on stage as Sir Ian McKellen had finished warming up the crowd, which was pretty spectacular. I mean, the audience was massive for that gig, and he was so lovely as well, and just really accommodating with everybody who wanted to speak to him and have fun at the stage, and he was a total gentleman. So, yeah, that was a really lovely moment for us.
Yeah, big fans.
Yeah.
You haven't managed to get him to appear in one of your videos yet, then?
No, unfortunately not. No. We may not have the budget for him, I fear.
Our video guy's a bit of a CGI wizard. Maybe we can do something on that regard. And just send him an email after the fact and go, by the way, you've been put in our video.
So one of the themes that we've been running through this series of interviews is asking people for their top 5, I guess, fantasy league bands in a festival lineup. So I want to ask the question to each of you. So Joe, do you want to go first?
Do you want me to give the whole 5, or are we going to do a composite lineup?
Oh, I don't know. Do you want to go? Do you want to go for your 5 first, and then we'll go through the band, and then you can argue it out with each other.
Yeah, we're probably going to cross over on a few of them, but for me, I would definitely want Queen on my bill. They were kind of one of the big bands for me when I was a kid, and Roger Taylor was the reason I ended up playing drums. So they were a really big influence. I think in complete contrast, I'd also want Rage Against the Machine on my festival lineup. So slightly different vibes there. I think I quite like Fleetwood Mac as well, because, big fans of them. And
that's a great shout.
I think they're kind of timeless, aren't they? I mean, they've got so many hits. And, also I was thinking potentially... I probably want Pink Floyd as well on my dream lineup, probably to close it out.
final one. I'm going to go for an oldie from my kind of childhood, but probably Nirvana.
Okay. Okay, Sarah, do you want to go next?
Reality, obviously, not intruding on that decision, is that?
No, we've basically said to everyone, dead or alive, or together, not together. So I've pointed out you could have Mozart fronting Metallica if you wanted to. That's all good. Go for it, Sarah.
Oh, me? Okay, so I would love Imogen Heap.
Right.
I would love to have Jeff Buckley.
That is a good show.
Then also Nothing But Thieves. Then I would definitely agree with Joe. I think Rage Against the Machine, and also AC/DC.
AC/DC. That'd be a good lineup. Dave.
Now mine's probably slightly more rock, certainly more prog than the other two, which they'll probably continually make fun of me for. But there is the one crossover, Rage Against the Machine, hands down, every time, probably first name on the bill for me. But after that, Primus. Got to have Primus. Probably Rush. And then I think my absolute favourite band of the moment, at the moment, for the last few years, is a British prog band called Haken, who are just incredible. So complete the prog thing. And then to round out five, I think I need Jimi Hendrix on there.
Is Jimmy headlining?
I think he'd have to, wouldn't he? I mean, who else, eh, from that lineup? I mean, you probably put Rage on supporting Jimmy. And then, although if you put all the prog on first, most people are going to go home, right? So I'd still be there. I'd be happy.
So we're going to listen to another one of your tracks now. Do you want to introduce it for us?
So we've got Angel next. And again, another little thing about this video, I think, well, if you've seen us live, we've definitely told this story before. But yeah, there's lots of fire in this video and it's all real. No CGI effects whatsoever. So if you want to check it out, yes.
Keep watching.
Yeah, keep watching.
Blame.
So welcome back, guys. We're going to do some quick fire questions now. So firstly, glamping or camping?
Glamping.
Glamping.
Too old.
Sorry, go on. Elaborate.
I just think, what's the point in suffering, right? I mean, if you can get in a really nice, glamorous glamping situation, why wouldn't you do that?
Absolutely.
I've been grubby enough in my teens. I don't need to carry that into my later life experiences. I know what it feels like to smell bad.
Notice he didn't give a real figure on his age then. He just said later life.
And yeah, we'll keep that a mystery, I think, as much as we can.
We will.
So, Blur or Oasis?
Blur.
Yeah, Oasis for me.
Oh.
What was Sarah's choice?
Oasis.
Digital or vinyl?
I'd say probably vinyl has the better sound, really. But for accessibility,
I don't own any vinyl, yeah. So I think, you know, again, yeah, vinyl in an ideal world, digital.
Just
yeah.
For reality,
digital for practical, yeah.
Okay.
We wouldn't be good at camping because we're like, you know, we're thinking of the practicalities of vinyl now. That's we're not very cool, are we?
Apparently not.
You could put one of those gramophones with the big horn in your tent. Go old school. Have your butler standing there winding it up for you.
Or Dave.
So that would mean I'd have to move the gramophone from the drawing room. What are you talking about?
So one of the things we've been doing in the series is talking about who would win a fight. It's a who would win a fight section. So we're going to do a slight twist on this, and Joe's gonna call it this time and give his two.
Okay, I'm going to say Zach De La Rocha and... I think Henry Rollins, I think that was an interesting thing. We batted some ideas around. Yeah, I think that would be a fight to the death. It would be brutal.
Who would win?
You know what? I'm going to say, practicality-wise, probably you think Henry Rollins, but I think Zach's got the crazy man rage. I think he'd do the thumbs in the eye socket or something, you know? You can never count that out. Scary stuff.
What do you reckon, Dave?
I think Joe's probably right there. I think Zach's too angry.
No one can handle that anger.
No.
So, guys, we're absolute pleasure. Thanks for coming on. And we can't wait to see you next year at Minety. We'll see you soon.
See you soon.
Thanks,
take care, guys.
Bye.
Thanks, guys. Awesome. Can't wait to see you next year. The hellos! See you next year! So it's an honour to introduce Jimmy Moore. Jimmy has supported Minety Music Festival since its origins, and he's been there every year, either in collaboration or as a solo artist, and it is my honour to introduce a couple of sets that he's done. And he's recorded directly for us. So without further ado, listen, here's Jimmy Moore.
What's that? So this is for Minety Music Festival goers who couldn't get battered this year, 2020, because of COVID. So I'm going to play a couple of songs. And here's to Minety Music Festival 2021. This is a song, I can't say the name of the band or it won't let me post it on Facebook or anywhere else. So this is called Siobhan, right? Take the bucket to the well, Siobhan, oh Siobhan, for you to boil your breakfast and to keep your cottage warm, for you to blend your whiskey so you can drink it here at home. Oh, please don't stay out every night for every pub to roam. Siobhan is on the whiskey, Siobhan is on the gin, Siobhan is looking for vodka, Red Bull.
is no sin. Siobhan's on the whiskey and she won't be home again. She waltzes in the bar, and all the boys around her coming from the near and far. I wish that I could go inside, I must stay in the car. Oh, please be still my beating heart, she shimmers like a star. And in the dim of dimmest night, she holds her court to see. I wish for just one moment she would have a drink with me. In the pub she is the centre, the life of every song. Well, if Siobhan is drunk, then Siobhan is having fun. Siobhan is on the whiskey, Siobhan is on the gin. Siobhan is looking for vodka, Red Bull won't be home again. I stay up late here every night, I know it is no sin. Siobhan is on the whiskey and she won't be home again. Siobhan is on the whiskey, Siobhan is on the gin. Siobhan is looking for vodka, Red Bull won't be home again. I stay up late here every night, I know it is no sin. Siobhan is on the whiskey and she won't.
Bashed it. This next one is one I'm probably gonna pick up as well. Oh, I just swore. Oh, God. Oh, no. Well, we'll try it. Anyway, see what happens. This one's called The Sick Note, and it's one that I would have done. It's a brand new one for the set, not a brand new song. You might know it. There we go. Sir, I write this note to you to tell you of my plight. For at the time of writing, I am not a pretty sight. My body is all black and blue, my face a deathly grey. And I write this note to say why Paddy's not at work today. While working on the 14th floor, some bricks I had to clear. To throw them down from such a height is not a good idea. The foreman wasn't very pleased, he'd been an awkward sod. He said I'd have to carry on down the ladder in my hod. Now clearing all these bricks by hand, it was so very slow. So I hoisted up a barrel and secured the rope below. But in my haste to do the job, I was too blind to see that a barrel full of building blocks was heavier than me. So when I untied the rope, the barrel fell like lead. And clinging tightly to the rope, I hit my bloody head. So clinging tightly, numb with shock from this almighty blow, the barrel spilled out half the bricks 14 floors below. Now when these bricks had fallen from the barrel to the floor, well, I then outweighed the barrel and so I started down once more. Clinging tightly to the rope, I fell towards the ground, and I landed on the scattered bricks that had landed all around. As I lay there moaning on the floor, I thought I'd passed the worst, when the barrel hit the pulley wheel and then the bottom burst. Well, a shower of bricks came down on me, I hadn't got a hope. As I lay there moaning on the floor, I let go of the kin rope. Well, the barrel being heavier, it started down once more and landed right across me as I lay there on the floor. Well, I broke three ribs in my left arm and I can only say, I hope you'll understand why Paddy's not at work today. Yeah. I'm sorry for swearing, Rich.
So thanks ever so much, Jimmy. Big love, man.